Welcome to Chess Castle. My name is Ivan Sokolov and this is chesscastle.net. Today we are going to be busy with Gambit in a Slav, Gellert Tolos Gambit. The starting position is one which you have in front of your eyes, namely it comes very often in a tournament practice. So typical Slav position, d takes e4, and here the main move which usually is played is move a4, and after bishop f5 you get immersed into huge amount of theory where actually it is quite difficult to get advantage with white, any advantage, next to the fact that there is a huge theory. So, and not everybody is really interested in learning variations 20 moves long. What I'm going to propose today is, in this DVD, what I'm going to propose is move e4. With move e4, white takes space. He doesn't bother about playing move like a4. What is the drawback of this move e4, taking immediate space? Because what more logical can it be than to take immediate space? Because with the last move d takes c4, black removed his pawn from the central square control. So then what is the more what is the problem in taking space? Problem is that it is gambit. Because after b5, black protects his c4 pawn. And this c4 pawn, you are not going to get back. This remains a pawn. So this is a pawn sacrifice. White takes space further, e5, knight d5. And now white plays move a4, being ready to undermine black queenside. And later force some black's decisions. So this is the starting position of the gambit against Slav, which we are going to be busy with in this DVD. The gambit is called Tolos-Geller gambit. Tolos and Geller are two famous Soviet grandmasters. Geller, Yefim Petrovich Geller, is known to wide chess public, I think, at least I hope so, because he was, for a period of maybe at least a decade, probably longer, he was one of the best players on this planet. And he played the candidate matches a couple of times. Aleksandar Kazimirovich Tolos is also a famous grandmaster, Soviet grandmaster, but he was not really, let's say, so successful on international chess scene, which means that he was more busy playing tournaments in the Soviet Union, playing Soviet championship finals many times. And being very well known as a theoretician, and this gambit is his contribution to chess theory. Both Tolos and the Geller, they actually started to experiment with this gambit on a high level in the end of the 40s, last century. So let's here start examining black options. Main theoretical move is of course move e6. Most logical move, black supports his knight and he wants to be ready to develop his bishop. Let's, in the first part of this DVD, be busy with the sidelines. Sidelines for black, so other moves apart from move e6. A number of those moves lead to clear advantage for white, or at least very dangerous initiative. But there are also actually options for black to consider, where it is difficult for white to get anything tangible. And this is maybe also interesting for a black side of a players, who, if they face Gellert Tolos Gambit, they would prefer not to play the main line e6, but to play one of those sidelines. From a white standpoint, of course, it is important to notice, to know that this remains a surprise weapon. And with surprise weapon, you want to actually bring a fight to your opponent. Right now, as early as move 7, you bring a fight to your opponent. And now black has to decide what to do. So let's start with, let's say, move bishop e6. Bishop e6 is having a very clear idea. Black wants to support this knight with his bishop instead of with the pawn. And with his bishop, he is hoping to recapture and to place this bishop on a nice square. On a diagonal. From this square, bishop will be hitting on the long diagonal. What is the drawback of this move? Well, drawback of this move we are going to see very soon. The drawback is that this bishop can well be attacked by this knight. Namely, this knight can jump on g5, attacking this bishop in an unpleasant way. So let's see how. White has here tried two moves. One move was to jump knight g5 immediately, but probably the most precise is to first take on b5, forcing knight c3, because black obviously cannot recapture, because then white gets his pawn back, and he's about to eat another pawn, pawn on c4. So this is not really what black wants, so black has to take, take, and take. Pawn structure on a queen side has now been determined, but now white has unpleasant jump, knight g5, bishop d5. You may wonder here, why is this knight g5 jump unpleasant? After all, black bishop is on a fantastic square. Next move is going to be e6, so bishop will be very well supported by the pawn on e6, so why is this actually unpleasant for black? This is unpleasant for black because white here has typical move for those positions. We are going to see this motive a number of times here. And also, even we see this motive in some Queen's Gambit accepted lines. White here plays move e6, very strong move. White sacrifices pawn in order to, first of all, weaken black king, and secondly, to slow down black development, because now black bishop and black rook are not going to develop that easy. So, fe6. It is maybe good to mention that bishop e6 is a very serious mistake, because white simply takes and check, and now white grabs pawn back, so now white is nothing down, and black is having all these terrible pawns, weak king. White also has a bishop pair advantage, so to take with bishop is impossible. fe6. Black is now two pawns up, but as I mentioned, those two pieces are not going to develop anytime soon. White has here tried in a practice move queen g4. It was tried actually by inventor of this gambit, Grandmaster Tolush, in his game with the former world champion Smyslov. Smyslov played move h5, and after queen f4, queen d6, check, bishop a3, queen f4, queen c7, sorry. Black had actually quite a decent compensation for a pawn, because this king is in the middle of the board. It is unclear whether black has more than whether white has more than compensation, but white has compensation for sure. However, pioneering attempts sometimes lead to some disasters, and in this game white made a blunder. White took bishop h5, which blundered. Nice tactics. Can you see it? Knight e5, and now former world champion Smyslov obtained a winning advantage. He is now well, two pawns up for nothing. However, a serious analysis show that actually probably the best way for white to play is to continue his development with bishop e2. And now black is in a quite a serious situation, because what white wants to do, let's suppose that black plays knight c6, white wants to castle. And obviously to play move rook e1, bishop g4, knight e6, and simply crush black. So the most logical move for black is to say, well, if I'm in trouble, then I might as well eat one more pawn. So bishop takes g2, knight e6, queen b6, rook g1, take e6, take g2. At the first glance, it looks like the situation is actually not so bad for black. He's still two pawns up, he traded some pieces. Yes, king is still in the middle of the board, but who cares? A lot of pieces can be traded. These dangerous knight jumps now don't exist because white knights are gone. But actually, in order to develop to finish his development, black is going to lose both of those pawns. And white is then going to establish material equality, and he will have a clear advantage. Now let's see how it goes. For example, if black plays move g6, rook g5 comes, and now, well, black is going to lose this pawn on c4, because bishop e3, bishop f3, now he would lose pawn on a7, Of course, with rook b8, bishop, sorry, bishop d5, actually, he would lose a queen, so he has to lose exchange, he's here completely lost. So knight d7 is maybe more logical move to try to speed up the development. Rook g5, a6, but now this take is quite unpleasant, takes. Black has managed to trade a pair of rooks, but he lost, however, one pawn in the process, and now he would lose, actually, both of those pawns. Let's see how. Queen d2. Queen e3, very strong move and unexpected, because you would expect that, actually, white wants to keep his queen, because he is a pawn down, and black has potentially open king, but no, white wants to trade queens. What is the point? The point is that black now cannot prevent a loss of both of those pawns, and white is going to remain a sound pawn up for nothing. Let's see how it goes. Bishop g7, attacking a pawn, rook b8. And now comes the point of whole white concept. I guess you see it already. Rook takes b5. Because pawn on c4 will fall. If takes, obviously take, and take rook, and black has two bishops, and an extra pawn, and should win this ending. And if rook to c8, then some simple move like rook b4, and again this pawn is going to fall, and white should win. So bishop e6 is not a great idea, because of the fact that in this particular position, e6 is a very strong move, and after fe6, bishop e2, it is impossible for black to finish his development, to finish developing those two horrible pieces and exposed and save and sheltering exposed king without suffering material losses. In order to do this, black is going to lose both of his extra pawns and then some, then probably pawn more. So bishop e6 is leading to bad position for black by force. Let's now examine move. Bishop, let's say, f5. Bishop f5 is a tricky move. Very tricky move, because it is not bad, but it is extremely risky, and I don't think would find very many followers. The main point is that after a takes b5, knight c3, which is the most logical move, again leads to problems, because after knight g5, move e6 is again going to be to spell trouble. Because if queen d5, then simply after bishop e2, knight c6, bishop f3, queen d7, now move e6 immediately can be played, and then just castle. And play for very strong initiative, but castles is also good. Rook c8, e6 is again good move, but rook e1 is also good. e6, and now move d5. Position opens very much to white favor. It has been seen in a game between Yermolinsky and Tukmakov, played in a Soviet Union in 1986. Black problem is simply that he's horribly behind in development. Bishop, not actually bishop d5, e6 is a problem. This is killing black first. Because now this rook opens, and after takes, bishop takes, and this pawn will fall, and king is in the middle of the board, black is going to lose everything.